on Sunday, look through a little bit of the slides, and it looks like we're going to have a really good technical talk. And I want to welcome Anita and Payal with our talk for profiling bad USBs. So please, ladies, take it away.
Hey everyone, I hope you're having a lovely morning. I'm Anita. I work for Target. I am part of their CISA team. I have a work experience of around 6 years, and it mostly involves SOC and IR environment. My main interest includes Windows host based analysis and network analysis itself. Here I am with Payal, and we are going to be presenting on the topic profiling bad USB attacks. I initially spiked an interest in these type of devices like early 2019, and then I started obsessively reading about them. Then I had to partner with Payal to study how these would look from like a CISA or a blue team perspective, like how do we start the investigation, how do we collect artifacts and all of the works. So here we are presenting some of our findings. I'm going to hand it over to Payal. She's going to get us started off, and I will join in later. While the stage is yours.
Thank you, Anita. Hello, everyone. I'm Payal RK, and I'm an incident handler at Target in the cybersecurity incident response team. I am a blue teamer by heart, and I love doing host-based and network-based analysis. I am super excited about this talk, and I hope you're all too, because we have some amazing information about bad USB devices to share with you all. If you're all set, then let's get started, shall we? Okay, over the last decade, the distinction between conventional warfare and cyber warfare has blurred, they say, due to the evolution in cyber attacks. Had somebody made the statement when I wasn't in the security team, it would be really hard for me to believe, as it is hard to imagine that cyber attacks can have an impact that it can be compared to a conventional warfare. But I've been here long enough to know that it is true. In this talk, we will be specifically be talking about one type of cyber attacks that involves USBs called the HID attacks. But before I tell you about HIDs and the HID attacks, I want you all to know that the central focus or the idea of this talk is to let you all know the data sources or the artifacts that can be used by the blue teamers or the detection teams to build detection around, or use these artifacts as a starting point if you are analyzing an incident that involves a USB. All right, let's get started with knowing what HIDs are. HID stands for Human Interface Device. They act as an interface between the users and the computers. They basically take input from the humans and provide output to the humans. Had this been an in-person conference, I would have asked you to guess which is the most commonly used HID device. But since this is a virtual conference, I'm just going to go ahead and tell you keyboard and mouse are the most commonly used HID devices. So what are HID attacks then? Basically, if you see a USB getting connected to your computer, and if it is trying to execute commands or run scripts by emulating a keyboard or a mouse, what you're noticing is a HID attack. Okay, we have established what HIDs are, what HID attacks are. In my next slide, I will be walking you through some of the devices that are used in the HID attacks. Okay, the first on my list is the PHUKD, which stands for Programmable HID USB Keystroke Dongle. This device is based off of a Teensy microcontroller board, which can either set off the payload when it is connected to a computer, or it can be set off when a timer is set, or when certain environmental conditions like noise, light, or temperature are met. This is one of the most primitive devices, you can say. It was available as early as 2009. The next on my list is the rubber ducky. I think it is the most popular among all these devices on the list. This device is popular due to the availability of ducky scripts. Ducky script is the format in which the scripts need to be to run on a rubber ducky. Also, this device has a high speed. So basically, it can type 1,000 words per minute and has a good storage capacity, which lets it have long script. Okay, the third one on my list is Urfucht. It stands for Universal RF USB Keyboard Emulation Device. This device is basically the wireless version of the PHUKD. This was designed with an intention to overcome the blind timing and the attack selection by making use of a RF transmitter to do these two things. But this device is a little larger than a normal looking thumb drive. So if you want a device to test out, say you want a user to believe that you're connecting a normal thumb drive, then this is not the device because it is slightly larger in size. The next one on my list is bad USB. Bad USB, even though it's a universal term that is used to refer to devices that are used in USB-based attacks, the one that I'm referring to was introduced in the year 2014 at a Black Hat conference by these two amazing engineers who were into embedded security. They thought, why design a new device when you can just exploit an inherent vulnerability in the USB firmware and reprogram it to do suspicious things? At the time, it was said that theoretically it works on every type of USB device, but this was in the year 2014. I am not sure how it works now. The next on my list is the WID injector or the Wi-Fi HID injector. This device is also referred to as rubber ducky on steroids by the security researcher who designed this device, because not only does it have rubber ducky like features, it also additionally has Wi-Fi capabilities. So you could remotely inject the payloads by connecting to the Wi-Fi. So the attacker could be in the building or outside the building if the Wi-Fi signal allows. I have a lot more to talk about this device in the next slide. So we will be moving on to the next device on this list, that is the USB Harpoon or OMG cable. This device was designed by taking an inspiration from the bad USB device that I mentioned earlier. So the security researchers thought, now that there is some awareness around thumb drives being used in suspicious activities, how about we leverage a charging cable to execute scripts or run commands? There's a POC that shows that a Mac device's USB cable, sorry, the charging cable was replaced with this cable, and the user was fooled into believing that it is a normal cable because it transmits both data and power. So there is no reason for an end user to suspect that anything suspicious is going on with this. And the last one on my list is the WID Elite. WID Elite is the second version of the WID tool. This practically achieves the wireless capabilities by making use of a 2G SIM. Currently, research is being done to make it compatible with 4G SIM as well. The SIM-like capabilities or the SIM on this device makes it possible for the attacker to have global remote capabilities. The attacker could be sitting on this end of the globe, and he could be injecting payload with this device on the other end of the globe. The SIM also allows it to have additional capabilities like GPS location tracking, or the attacker could just turn on the microphone, eavesdrop the audio back to him or her. So it is amazing. There's a lot more to this device. So if you're interested, you can read up about it on their website as well. Now that I've spoken enough about all these devices, let's move to the next slide, where I will be talking a little bit more about the device that I and Anita used for our testing purposes, or we tested it out practically. The Wi-Fi HID injector was designed by Luca Bongiorni. This device is capable of running payloads on three different platforms, Windows, OS X, and Linux. This device can exfiltrate data both on the via serial communication and Wi-Fi. Plus, the VID and the PID on this device can be changed, so you can easily evade DLP agents. Plus, this device has an ESP12 chipset, which allows it to have Wi-Fi capabilities, DNS support, 4MB flash memory, and that also has a pinout for weaponization of USB gadgets. Now, what does weaponization of USB gadgets mean? It means the next time you receive a gift at a conference or from anybody that is based off of a USB, say a heating cup or a USB light, please do not connect it to a computer that you care about, because it could be equipped with a device like the WID. And this device also has auto start function. So earlier I mentioned this device is also referred as rubber ducky on steroids. So basically if you wanted to use a rubber ducky but did not want to pay as much, then you could just use a vid injector in the auto start function. And it is very affordable. It comes at a mere $13 and it is easily shipped from China. All right, I have spoken enough about this device. Now it is time for us to move on to talk about the data sources and the artifacts that we promised you earlier. But there's one last step. We need to tell you about the attack simulation that we used so that we could base off of a paper on it. Can we go to the next step? Yeah. All right. When we were testing this out in a test environment, we made use of a Windows-based operating system computer, and we decided to go with one of the scripts that is readily available on the Git repo of this device. Basically, what this script do is it's used for phishing purposes. It prompts the user for entering their username and password. And once the user does that, it is staged for exfil via serial communication. The vid injector requires the script to be in a particular format, but we know that we have readily available scripts related to this device on their Git repo. Additionally, all the ducky scripts that are returned for rubber ducky can be easily converted by using a vid converter. And it can be used with this device. All right, I have spoken about how we designed the attack to be. Now let's move to the most interesting part. We're going to talk about three data sources. I will be covering the first one, then Anita will be covering the other two, and she has the most interesting ones. And the first one is the registry keys. If you have been in security and if you have gone through the registry keys, you know that you cannot just start looking into the registries because there are at least 40,000 registry key locations. You need to have some background when you are looking into the registry keys. And you also need to have some knowledge around what each registry hive is used for. For example, every hardware that is connected or is associated with the Windows computer has information about it under the system hive. And similarly, every USB device that is connected to a Windows computer has to register itself under this registry key that I've mentioned on the slide, HKLM under system current control set enum USB. When the devices do so, they have information about, they have a device description, they have the VID and the PID, who's the manufacturer and the last access time. When we connected this device, the vid injector, identified itself as a composite device. Then it went on to register under different functions. First, it registered itself as a HID device. Then it identified itself as a serial communication device. It is very rare that a thumb drive-like looking device would register for these two services. So that is your first red flag. And once you do that, you can look at the device description and the VID and the PID to know more about this device. The next logical location for you to look in the registries would be the run MRU key, because these devices generally open a run prompt either to execute commands or to spin up PowerShell and start running scripts from there. So this is the next logical location to look. It is under the software hive, and I've mentioned the location on the screen. MRU stands for most recently used. This way, once you find the information here, based off of that, you need to look at the other registry key locations. Like if you want to look up if the device was connected to a Wi-Fi around the time of the incident, you have a specific registry key. This way, you can start looking in the registry all day long, and I can speak about it all day long, but I do not want to hold you off here. I will ask Anita to take it from here so that she can talk about the other data sources that can be used in the analysis of a security incident. Anita, can you please take it from here?
Yes, Payal, thank you so much. Now, I don't want to waste any of your time, so now that we've looked at the registry keys, I'm just going to move on to the Windows events. The Windows events could be invaluable when it comes to investigation. Here, we are going to be looking at some events that are not only going to get us help on identifying the USB itself, but it's going to get us the time the USB was connected to the host itself and who exactly connected it. So we are looking at three questions, which is what, when, and by whom. We here have mentioned three event IDs, that is event ID 410, 20001, and 6416. Event ID 410 is for kernel PNP. This event ID is recorded the first time the USB is connected to the host itself. I have attached a screenshot for you here so you can see what all details it actually provides. It provides the VID and the PID, which can help us uniquely identify the USB that was connected. It has also given me the date and time of when it was connected. And it also gives me the driver and the service. Here you can actually quite clearly see it first recognized itself as a composite device, which means we were expecting more than one function from it. But then it goes to register itself as a mouse and a keyboard as well. Like, how often do you see that? It's not very common for a single device to register itself as a mouse and a keyboard itself. It is at this point that I have to acknowledge how clever these devices are. But if you are also thinking, maybe if the USB is behaving weirdly, maybe my antivirus was going to detect it, but the chances of your antivirus detecting such a USB is very slim to none, because as far as your system or antivirus is concerned, this is just a keyboard that has been connected to the host itself. So now, before I stray away from the topic, I just want to come back. So in event ID 20001, which was for the PNP device driver installation, here you can see it was also recognized as a serial communication device as well. So adding up, it all looks really suspicious, but we still don't have the data of who connected it. If you are looking at a system that's only used by a single user, you may already have the details of who connected it. But what happens when a particular host is being used by multiple users and you want to see that? That's when we go to event ID 6416. This also captures the similar data. It gives you the VID, PID, and the detect time and everything. But it also gives you the account name, who connected the USB to the host. So this event ID is particularly useful when you're looking at events where the host was shared by multiple users. And also, unlike event 410, this event is logged every time an external device is connected to the computer itself. So it also helps you understand the behavior of the user. So you're going to be seeing if it was regular for the user to connect USB devices to his host, or if it was only a one-time thing, or has this USB been connected multiple times? So what does that mean? So it gives you more information or insight into what the user behavior itself. Now that we've looked into when the USB was connected and what USB was connected, we need to know what else it did on the host itself. And for that, as Payal had mentioned, you can always check the MRU registry key. But depending upon when the detection happened or when it was reported, it is possible that the MRU key was rewritten or in some cases even erased. And so I suggest the next logical point that we look into is PowerShell. You may have questions as to why exactly PowerShell. I'm going to explain it. With the bad USBs itself, the thing is the characteristics that let it be undetected also limits its potential. In the sense, to remain undetected, the bad USB can never contain a malicious payload in itself. That means they can only contain scripts that when executed can download malware payloads or establish a CNC or whatever the attacker or pen tester wishes. So in the sense, they need a script to be executed, and for that they need a shell. And given how PowerShell is versatile and really powerful, it is the obvious shell of choice, especially in a Windows host. We saw this being used not only in the various scripts that were available on the internet, but also in the Fin7 campaign that they used. We'll go over that in like a minute. So PowerShell. When we mention PowerShell, you can always go to a PowerShell prompt itself, try to do a get history and get all of the logs, but then they can always be erased. So the first thing I should be looking at is event IDs 400 and 403, which explain to me if a PowerShell session was running during the time of the alert itself or when the USB was connected. But these event IDs usually does not contain more information. And that's why we're going to be coming to event ID 4688, which is for a new process has been created. This event ID is like a silver bullet to any investigator or analyst itself, because it contains loads of information. It contains the command line, the process ID, the parent process, the execution time, and the user account name, which is going to tell us what the command that was executed it in the PowerShell, and which can help us understand what happened next. But the disadvantage with this event ID itself is that it's not enabled by default. In the sense, if you do not enable this event ID, then there is a good chance that you missed it. But luckily, we do have backup logs where you can check. And that would be your PS readline text. This is a record that is present under the Windows PowerShell folder. And it records every PowerShell command that was ever run on the host itself. It cannot be erased by clearing the history, but there is also one disadvantage. I'm going to explain it to you. So as you see here in the screenshot itself, in the payload that I was testing, we had this particular function that was defined. And as you can see at the very last, it was called. But what you don't see here is a timeline. In the sense, though the PS readline record is very useful in seeing the PowerShell logs, it does not give you a time on when this log was actually executed. But it can also give you more insight. It can tell you how often it is that the user uses PowerShell and what are the commands that he usually executes. So it is useful. So to find the time, we are going to be looking at event ID 4104, which is for script block logging. This event is recorded whenever PowerShell calls a function, a script, or even a commandlet. And that's what we see here. Here, I see the function being called. And at that point, the event ID 4104 is triggered. Here, it captures the function call as well as the function definition. Apart from that, it also gives me the time and the username and the computer, which can be useful as a backup when you're not when you haven't captured the 4688 records. So at this point, I'm going to say our investigation is going to branch out into different directions, because depending upon what command was executed in PowerShell, it is possible that they downloaded a second stage payload maybe that might need to run to do whatever happens next. Or maybe they establish a CNC and we might need looking into network logs. Or in this particular case itself, it was going to prompt me for credentials and then it was going to serially exfil this. So it's going to branch out into different directions, and it's not within the scope of this presentation itself to cover every direction that we're going in. So I think we reached a natural stopping point. The event IDs that we have covered so far and the registry keys itself should give you the much needed information on how to start the analysis on bad USBs and how to find the initial steps that they require. Now, I am going to be moving into another interesting perspective. But before that, I do have to explain that so far we have been looking at a scenario where we assumed a bad USB was already connected to the host and we were going in checking for artifacts. But here on, we are going to be looking into a scenario where you came across a USB or an OTG cable that was just left at your desk, or maybe it arrived in a mail that you were not expecting, or maybe even was left to you in a parking lot, or someone reported it to the security team itself. And I do have to suggest strongly that you, when you're connecting any unknown USB to a host, please do it under lab conditions, because not just that it may be a bad USB, but it could be, you know, just any unknown USB. If you think that's a little bit of paranoia, you should be reading the paper by the researchers at the Ben Gurion University in Israel, because they had actually defined 29 different types of attacks that can be established using USB. So please do this in a lab environment. Now, what was the interesting perspective that I was talking about is the use of USB PCAP module in Wireshark itself. This is again going to give us most information that we need, but I suggest using this because this could be one point contact where I could be able to identify the USB as well as get the script that the USB was going to execute itself. So when a USB is connected to a host, it's going to go through this kind of handshake where it's going to exchange information or parameters that are necessary for the USB and the host to work together as well. And that details are captured under what is known as the control transfers. And it is 6 packets of information for every USB that's connected to the host. These packets are named get device descriptor request and response, get configuration descriptor request and response, and set configuration request and response. The request is obviously from the computer or the host that you've connected the USB to the USB, and the response is from the USB itself. Though there are multiple parameters that are being exchanged during that time, we are mostly going to be looking into 3 particular parameters that's going to help us identify the USB. So here I have a simple looking white flash drive that I want to profile, and I have connected to my system and started the capture. The first one that I want to be looking into is the device descriptor. This is going to give me the details on the vendor ID and the product ID. We have been talking about it so long, so I'm going to tell you how it helps. So every vendor ID and product ID will help you uniquely identify the chip of the USB, and it's mostly unique, so you should be able to find the vendor of and the device itself. Here you see the vendor ID is ID vendor field and the product ID is ID product field, and it's a hex value. I just need to do a little bit of Googling to understand that this vendor ID is actually a Lilypad Arduino micro board, which is not usually seen in commercial flash drives. Arduino micro boards are usually seen when you want to do customized function with the devices. So that would be my first red flag. And second one, I'm going to be looking at the configuration descriptor, and I'm going to be looking at the field known as the BMAX power. What this field describes is the maximum power the USB might need at its fullest working potential. In the sense, different USBs work under different power ranges, and this is going to help us understand what USB it actually is. Here you see it's at around 500 milliamps, which is on the higher end. And when I checked, it was not in the ranges of a flash drive, which is usually in the ranges of 30 to 60 milliamps. It was rather in the working ranges of a keyboard, which was anywhere between 100 to 500 milliamps. So this was my second red flag. And then moving on, there is one more field we could be looking into, the interface descriptor itself. And that is the interface, we can be looking on into the configuration descriptor itself, and that's the interface descriptor. The interface descriptor is the definition of the interface class the USB is going to be using. So it describes the action the USB is going to be performing in this computer itself. So here I see the class is HID, which as Payal explained is for input device. But if it was a normal, unsuspicious flash drive itself, I should be seeing the class mass storage device, which is usually seen for flash drives. But here I rather see it is a HID. And then I look into the physical attributes of the device itself, and I can come to a good conclusion that whatever I'm dealing with here is a bad USB. And now that me and Payal have been going on about bad USBs for half an hour, you should know what was the next step to expect. And that would be a script getting inputted in the host itself. So how do you capture that? So the script is similar to a keyboard pressing each key, and hence we will be seeing those details under what is known as the interrupt transfers. Interrupt transfers are logged whenever a keyboard or a mouse is connected to the system itself and there is a mouse movement or a key being pressed. And here we are going to be looking at the field known as the leftover capture data. This is usually a 8-byte information that explains the key that was being pressed. But with this particular device itself, we saw it to be a 9-byte information. And as you can see here, in every packet, the first byte remained unchanged, which made me think it was some kind of padding. So I'm just going to be ignoring the first field and going on over about the other 8 bytes. In these other 8 bytes, the first byte should explain any control keys being pressed. In the sense, it could be a control, alt, or shift key being pressed, because when pressed, they could change the characteristic of a key. For example, I could just press 2, or I could do a shift and 2, which change the character that is being entered. So that's why this particular byte is important. And then everything from the 3rd byte to the 8th byte itself represents a key being pressed. And as you see here, I see the 3rd byte constantly changing. And this value can actually be mapped back to a key that is being pressed in the keyboard using the USB HID scan codes. Since it is going to be a script, we are going to be seeing hundreds of packets like this. Don't worry, you don't have to go and change every reverse engineer every single packet. There are multiple scripts that are available on the internet that can do this for you. So once you reverse engineer all of these packets, you should be able to see the script itself. In the sense, not just the PowerShell command, the whole script itself, like the PowerShell being opened using the run prompt and everything. So this could be actually useful as a one point where you can not only identify the USB that is being used, but also the script that is being inputted from the USB itself. Now, there is still one question that might linger. Like, we have been talking about bad USBs. So is it being used in the wild, or is it being used only by red teamers and pen testers? Though bad USBs itself are not a known tactic with the malicious actors, we actually saw the first recorded instance of bad USBs being used in the wild as early as March 2020. This was a campaign carried out by the APT group known as Fin7 or Carbonac, where they mailed bad USBs through the US Postal Service to various companies in the hospitality sector. And these USBs started popping up everywhere, that the FBI actually had to send out an advisory stating that if you did receive an unsolicited USB in the mail, it could be an attempt by cybercrime gangs to compromise your system. And so if you do receive it, then to report it to your local FBI office. TrustWave was actually the first one to discover this campaign because one of their clients showed up with the USB, which was particularly suspicious. And they did do a whole research around this, and that is what the workflow you see here. So they explained that when the bad USB was connected to the device, it recognized itself as a keyboard, which is a trusted device. And then it opened the PowerShell command prompt and typed out a command, which downloaded the second stage payload. The second stage payload was again a PowerShell script, which when executed, installed the malware on the host itself. And also it did establish a CNC. And at this point, what happened was the main function kept going into this infinite loop, where every 2 minutes it received commands from the command and control itself. So it kept executing as also it used CNC as a method of persistence. This all sounds scary, right? But your bad USB attacks itself can be stopped. Like, we can stop every other cyber attack out there. So what do you do to make sure that you do not become a victim to said attacks? We have three tools in our arsenal, that would be early detection, user awareness, and threat hunting. So with early detection, we have been talking about it, and by now you should also understand that bad USBs are notoriously really hard to detect. But we can always build detections around the expected behaviors. Maybe we could build a block list of any suspicious VIDs, or we could look for any suspicious PowerShell commands being executed and this stuff. With the building the block list itself, it is a little bit tricky because as Payal had explained before, VIDs and PIDs in these devices can definitely be changed. And that's why this makes it harder with not just using a block list. There are other solutions, like there is Duck Hunter for Windows, which is like a small daemon program that runs in the background itself, and it's going to be monitoring the speed of the keyboard input. And it has four modes, and depending upon the mode you set it to, they claim they can only log the device that is log the attack that is happening, or even stop it. With the Linux and Chromebooks, there is another solution that's called the USB Guard. It is by Google. And this is also another daemon that runs in the background, but this works most on an allow and block list. In the sense, if you connected a USB to a host, it would be blocked unless it is in the allow list, which would be useful in like a smaller environment or the individual user itself, because they may be more aware of what USBs are being connected. But when it comes to really large enterprises, this mechanism can be actually cumbersome. So what do we do in that case? And that is where threat hunting can actually help. When you're doing threat hunting and looking at data from an enterprise level, it can make you understand the USBs that are regularly used in the environment itself and what is not. And it can actually help you determine the very unique USBs, say for like in 100 million logs, you see just one USB occurring once, then that is something we need to be looking into. And threat hunting, regular threat hunts can actually help us build a block list from scratch itself. But I had explained earlier, it could become quite cumbersome with large enterprises. So that is where I come to the final weapon in our arsenal, that is user awareness itself. Because user awareness is one of the most powerful prevention methods that we can ever have. Because when it comes to bad USBs itself, it takes less than 5 seconds between the USB being plugged and a second stage being downloaded or a CNC being established. And depending upon the technical awareness of the user, they may not even understand the thing that's going on their system, or they may be even unaware or not see anything at all. If you are thinking that, I don't think anyone is going to be plugging in an unknown USB into the system, then the results of the 2016 Google research is not going to be promising. Because they said when the USB drop attacks were used, 45% of the subjects had actually picked up a USB from a random location and actually plugged them into their host itself. This also kind of puts it into perspective on the much need for awareness, because when done right, this could be one of our most powerful strategies. It's just not about, you know, protecting the enterprise itself. It's also about protecting personal data. No one wants to get hacked, because at the end of the day, there are only two goals, that's safety and security. And that brings me to the end of the presentation. Our contact details are here. You can reach out to us with any questions. Thank you for your time. I think we're going to stay on for a little bit more if you have any questions itself.
Great, thank you. Yes, it's a great presentation and drove some interesting conversation. We have a couple questions that have come in. One of them is, for the USB scripts, do they have the ability of encoding their payloads when executing in the command line? And if so, might that be a good indicator of malicious behavior?
I'm going to take that question. Yeah, they can always encode the command itself, because it, at the end of the day, the it's just inputting some keys into your key host itself, so it can be encoded. That's what, when we are looking at what happens in the host level itself, we should be able to understand if this was regular for the user. Anyways, no one's going to be using encoded commands. So yes, it is a good indicator of malicious behavior.
And I would suggest it's always good to have detection built around encoded commands, since PowerShell lets you do it automatically using hyphen encoded. So it's always good to have detection built around it.
That's a fair point. Somebody else had made the comment for the logging of PowerShell commands.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes administrators will add their password to escalate privilege for scripts that they deploy across the organization. You'll also catch those. So just as a warning to our viewers, I propose that it's a great way to get them to change their habit by showing them their passwords, but that's just me. As for right now, that's all the questions that we have. Thank you again for a great presentation and for coming and presenting at B-Sides Toronto. By all means, hop into the Discord and continue the conversation there.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.